In the last video, we learned about the Watson and Crick model for the three-dimensional structure of DNA. This is the familiar double helix model. Underlying that model is the complementary base pairing rule. A pairs with T and G pairs with C when they are upside down or anti-parallel to each other. As soon as Watson and Crick published this model in 1953, scientists immediately began an intense research focus on DNA. Since replicability is one of the primary characteristics of the genetic material, a race immediately ensued to figure out how DNA is replicated. There were three competing models for how new DNA must be made. One was the conservative model. In this model, an old double-stranded molecule was hypothesized to produce a new molecule of DNA where both strands were newly made. Another model was called the dispersive model. Here, portions of one strand of DNA were replicated and other portions of the other strand were replicated, and then these parts were stitched together such that all of the resulting DNA strands had some old parts and some new parts. In 1958, just 5 years after Watson and Crick, Matthew Meselson and Franklin Stahl figured it out. A summary of their experiment is shown on the right side of this slide. We don't have time to discuss this experiment, but it's been called the most beautiful experiment in biology. If you want a model for how to do a great lab practical too, this is the model. But back to what they discovered. A third model called the semi-conservative model of DNA replication turned out to be the correct model. In this model, the two strands of double-stranded DNA are separated from one another. Then, each old strand is replicated to produce a new complementary and anti-parallel strand. Following Meselson and Stahl, many researchers set about finding the detailed mechanisms of semi-conservative DNA replication. Here are some of the steps. When a cell enters S phase of the cell cycle and a chromosome begins to undergo replication, one of the first things that happens is that an enzyme called DNA helicase binds to the double-stranded DNA. DNA helicase is like the tab of a zipper. When it moves, the two old strands, shown as light blue strands, separate from each other. When the old strands of DNA are separated, an enzyme called RNA polymerase makes short things called RNA primers. RNA is a very similar molecule to DNA. We'll describe RNA in the next video. It shows complementary base pairing and anti-parallel relationship with DNA. RNA primers are a few nucleotides long. They're temporary structures that act as binding sites for the primary replication enzyme, DNA polymerase. DNA polymerase binds to an RNA primer. DNA polymerase then begins to move down the old, light blue strand of DNA. If DNA polymerase reads an A on the old strand, it adds a T to the growing new strand. DNA polymerase then moves to the next nucleotide. If there's a G on the old strand, DNA polymerase adds a C to the new strand. DNA polymerase always moves along the old strand of DNA in the 3' to 5' direction. On the top old strand, DNA polymerase is moving right to left. This is the same direction as DNA helicase is moving. So the new strand in the top of the picture can be synthesized in one long continuous piece. We call this the leading strand. The old strand on the bottom runs 3' to 5' from left to right. Thus, the DNA polymerase is reading this old strand move in the opposite direction to DNA helicase. This means as DNA helicase unzips more of the length of the double-stranded DNA, new RNA primers have to be laid down, and new DNA polymerase enzymes need to serve these newly opened regions. The new DNA strand is created in fragments. We call this new strand the lagging strand. At some point, DNA polymerase goes back, finds the RNA primers, removes them, and puts DNA in their place. Then, when two DNA fragments are adjacent to each other, the sugar phosphate backbones of these fragments are connected together by an enzyme called DNA ligase. Again, as DNA helicase unzips more double-stranded DNA, a new primer and new DNA polymerase must go to work. Because of its fragmented nature, the lagging strand takes longer to build than the leading strand. Each bit of processing runs the risk of error, so the lagging strand has a slightly higher mutation rate than does the leading strand. but damage and mutations can happen to either strand. As DNA polymerase reads the old strand of DNA and builds a new complementary DNA strand, the backside of the DNA polymerase enzyme proofreads the new strand. If it finds a mismatch or a non-complementary pair, it will back up and fix this mistake. DNA polymerase proofreading isn't 100% efficient. Sometimes non-complementary pairs persist after DNA replication is complete. The cell then employs a second mismatch repair system that performs an additional layer of proofreading and fixing of those non-complementary pairs. This can be seen in the second frame. Occasionally, the mismatch repair system incorrectly identifies the new strand with the incorrect nucleotide as the old strand. It will then change the old strand to be complementary to the new strand. This will result in a mutation, a permanent change in the nucleotide sequence of DNA. The third form of DNA repair shown here is the nucleotide excision system, also called the UV repair system. Sometimes the nitrogenous bases of two adjacent nucleotides bind with one another. This often happens to two thymines when the DNA absorbs ultraviolet light. The fused thymines are called thymine dimers. The nucleotide excision system finds and cuts out thymine dimers. It then puts in new individual thymines and everything is fixed. But sometimes, instead of using new individual thymines, the nucleotide excision system puts in individual cytosines. This creates CA mismatches. The mismatch repair system will then find and fix these, but as stated above, the mismatch repair system isn't perfect and mutations can result. Together, the DNA replication system, which works from the simple complementary base pairing rule, along with the multiple layers of DNA repair systems, means that DNA can be replicated DNA produced in S phase of the cell cycle has an incredibly high probability of being done correctly. And the genes that are contributed to the next cell generation are the correct protein recipes. In the next set of videos, we'll discuss how those recipes are cooked so that the correct proteins are made.